स्टैंडर्ड हिस्ट्री चैप्टर नंबर 7 इंडिया एंड ईरान पॉइंट नंबर 7.4 पॉलिटिकल एंड कल्चरल इंपैक्ट ऑफ इरानियन कॉन्टैक्ट स्टडी इन डिटेल पॉइंट नंबर 4 इंपैक्ट ऑफ द इरानियन कॉन्टैक्ट The Persian supremacy prevailed in India for at least 2 centuries. However, it had ended much before the advent of Alexander. Now, thinking of the impact left by the Persian contact in the period of 2 centuries, one thing we can notice, it is about the administrative system set by the Persian rulers. Every conquered region was annexed to their territory as a satrapy, and a satrap's governor was appointed as its chief administrator. This method was followed by Alexander and later by the Sethian, Saka and Kushnas ruler as well. Let's study the impact on script. The Aramaic script came into use in the north eastern regions of the Indian subcontinent during the times of Achaemenid's rule, Kharoshthi, and ancient Indian script evolved from this script. The Ashokan edicts in this region are inscribed in the Aramaic script. The method of installing royal edicts at vantage point seemed to be borrowed from the example of Achaemenid's inscription. Father of history, Herodotus, tell us that Dariush I had sent many explorers to gather information about the course of the river Sindhu and the Arabian Sea. Among them was Salex of Karyanda, a Greek sailor from Ionia, who was well known. He was the first Ionian Greek who stepped on the Indian land. Salex began his exploration from the Sindhu and proceeded further by sailing around the coast of the Arabian Sea and then entering the Red Sea. He ended his journey at Suez, situated in the delta region of the Nile. It took 2.5 years for him to complete this journey. The logbook of the journey of the Salex is known as Periplus of Salex. The original Periplus is lost, but we get it know about it content from the writing of the Greek historians. This Periplus was the first source of information of the Indian subcontinent to the Western world, especially to the Greeks. Very soon after the completion of the expedition by Salex, Dariush I conquered the region in the lower reach of the Sindhu. Salex had reported about the existing canal that linked the Nile and Red Sea. It was dug by an Egyptian pharaoh. Darius I revived that canal by digging it again. It opened a new waterway for the transport between Persia and the Indian subcontinent. The newly available route facilitated the trade between Achaemenid's provinces in the northwestern region of the Indian subcontinent and the region of Sindh Punjab. The ivory and the teak wood coming from India had a great demand in the Persian markets. The inscription of Darius I at Susa records the use of Indian ivory and teak woods for building the palace. Herodotus has described the Indian soldiers in the Achaemenid's army. According to Xerxes, army had soldiers from Gandhara, Sindh, and Punjab. When he invaded Greece in 480 BCE, the soldiers from Gandhara were equipped with bows made of cane and spear with short shaft. They also had horses and chariots drawn by horses. The Indian soldiers from Sindh and Punjab used cotton clothes and used bows and arrow made of cane. They were expert archers. When Xerxes retreated from Greece, it was decided to keep a regiment that posted there. That regiment had Indian soldiers. Now it's time to study the impact on coins in the times before Cyrus II, the founder of Achaemenid's empire. There was no coinage in use in Persia. The barter system prevailed to a large extent. Sometimes silver ingots of particular weight were used for exchanging commodities. Cyrus II had conquered the city state of Lydia, where use of coins was already in practice. Those coins were known as strata. Cyrus issued coin similar to Lydian coins. Darius I issued coins with his own portrait on it. The golden coins issued by him were known as Daric, and silver coins were known as siglos. A portrait of Dariush I holding a bow and arrow you can see on these coins. One derrick was equivalent to 12 siglos in value. Along with the Achaemenid's coins, coins from Greek satrapies also remain in circulation in Persia. Some satraps issued their own coins imitating Greek coins. These coins were cast in molds. The obverse side of a coin usually carried the portrait of a king, and the reverse side had a symbol punched on it. So it is possible that the ancient Indian punchmark coins were influenced by the technique of punching. The practice of building huge public monuments did not exist in Persia. There was no existing Persian architectural style to follow while creating the magnificent palaces and sculptures in Susa and Persepolis. For that purpose, Emperor Cyrus got Greek architect and sculptor from the Greek settlement in Asia Minor under his rule. Persepolis was razed completely by Alexander after conquering Persia. It was the end of the Persian Empire. The architects, sculptors, and other artisans lost the royal patronage. They had to move out in search of work. They migrated to India. They received royal patronage in the court of Emperor Ashoka. Their style is reflected in the stone pillars erected by Emperor Ashoka. Thus, the sculptural art in ancient India has its root in the Persian and accordingly in the Greek sculptural style. Next point, point number 5, Takshila. Mahabharat mentioned King Takshaka as the king of Naga people. Takshila was capital of King Takshaka. The archaeological evidence confirmed that Takshila has a hoary past. It was the capital of Gandhara Mahajanpada. The archaeological remains of this city are strewn over a large area that comprises 18 archaeological sites. They are enlisted as World Cultural Heritage. It is situated on the Grand Trunk Road, 30 km away from Islamabad, the capital of Pakistan. Evidence of prehistoric people using microlith have been found at Takshila and in the some cave in its vicinity. The Neolithic village at Takshila was settled around 3500 BCE. Its remains have been found at a site called Sarai Khola. Takshila was ruled by King Ambi at the time of Alexander's advent. He welcomed Alexander
and presented gift to him. The Greek historian accompanying Alexander described Takshila as a city full of hustle bustle of people, prosperous, and the one that was under a well-established administration. It was a center of education. Some information about Takshila can be gathered from the Buddhist literature and from the writing of Greek historians. There were several learned individual acharyas staying in Takshila. Many students from various regions of Indian subcontinent were attracted to Takshila because of the fame of the acharyas. Takshila had become a great center of education. Thereby, it had assumed the magnitude of a natural university. However, the king and his administration at Takshila did not interfere in the decision of an individual acharya. As to the nature of his method of teaching, the subject to be taught by him, or the nature of the syllabus, the duration of a course was depend on individual students' intellectual capacity to learn. There was no formal system of examination. Rather, success in examination was not perceived as the test of real knowledge. It was the acharya who decided the level of maturity of his student. Talking about the subject taught at Takshila, it includes Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, ancillary branches of Veda, ancient tradition and ethics, philosophy, mathematics, music, medicine, Purana text, history, weaponry, poetry, etc. Acharya Chanakya is believed to have taken Chandragupta Maurya to Takshila for education. When he was young, Chanakya himself hailed from Takshila. After becoming the emperor of Magadha, Chandragupta Maurya established a regional capital at Takshila. During the reign of Ashoka Maurya, Takshila became an important center of learning of Buddhist tradition. Takshila did not lose its importance even when the land suffered from the invasion of Greek, Sakas and Kushnas. However, in the 5th century CE, the glory of Takshila gradually went under the pressure of Hunna invasions. Sixth point, or last point of this chapter, advent of Alexander. Alexander invaded the Indian subcontinent and conquered some kingdoms from Afghanistan to Sindh Punjab. He, however, could not establish his rule there for a long time. The information about his advent come from Greek historian like Arrian, Curtis, Diodorus, Plutarch, and Justin. At the time of Alexander's advent, the Achaemenids' rule in Sindh Punjab and Afghanistan had weakened, and a number of small kingdoms had come into existence. The political conflict stopped them from uniting to resist Alexander's invasions. Alexander became the king of Macedonia in 334 BCE. He defeated Emperor Darius III in 331 BCE. Thereafter, he marched up to Sistan, province of Iran, and from there he turned toward Kabul. After conquering the region around Kabul, he reached the foothills of Hindu Kush mountain. Then he camped at a place called Alexander became the king of Macedonia in 334 BCE. He defeated Emperor Darius III in 331 BCE. He marched up to Sistan province of Iran, and from there he turned toward Kabul. After conquering the region around Kabul, he reached to the foothill of Hindu Kush mountain. Then he camped at a place, Nikai, situated on Uttarpada. Ambi welcomed Alexander and sought friendship with him. Another king whose name was Sisikotas, Shashigupta, surrendered to Alexander. However, not all Indian kings surrendered to Alexander so easily. Many fought with Alexander with great valor. Alexander conquered almost all kingdoms in Kabul, Sindh, and Punjab. Hydaspes that fought between Alexander and Porus on the bank of Jhelum. Both confronted each other, and there was a battle between them. Porus was defeated, but Alexander and his army was greatly influenced by his valor. The Greeks were unfamiliar to the use of elephant in warfare. To penetrate the files of elephant proved to be great a challenge for them. The Greek historians have unanimously praised the skill of Porus in warfare and also his courage. After confrontation with Porus, Alexander reached Nysa, a Greek settlement. People of Nysa resisted Alexander in the beginning, but later they welcomed him. Thereafter, Alexander proceeded in the direction of Chenab and Ravi. He conquered the kingdom on the way and reached the bank of Bias. By that time, Alexander's soldier had lost spirit and refused to march forward. Alexander was forced to return. Before he returned, he handed over the region in Punjab to Porus and those in Sindh to Ambi. He handed over the kingdom of Kashmir to Abhisara, the king of Varanavati. On his way back, he defeated Shibis and Malas. In the rest of the region, he appointed Greek satraps, means governor. In 325 BCE, Alexander died at Babylon while he was on his way back to Greece. Alexander's invasion of India did not have far-reaching impact on political scenario of India. In a very short period after his death, Chandragupta Maurya established his vast empire from Bihar to Afghanistan. The highway linking the region from Bihar to Afghanistan is known as Grand Trunk Road in modern days. It was in use as a trade route even during the time of Gautama Buddha. It was known as Uttrapatha in those days. The starting point was at the port city of Tamralipti in Bengal, known as Tamluk today. It ended at Takshila. Emperor Chandragupta Maurya established his highway in a well-planned way. It is about 3200 kilometers in length. Emperor Ashoka provided many essential amenities for the merchant and traveler on this highway, such as planting tree on both sides of the road, sarai for overnight stay, etc. He erected pillars at vantage point on this highway. At a later period, Shesasur and Emperor Ashoka rebuilt this highway. In the British period, a new metalled road running parallel to Grand Trunk Road was built from Kolkata to Peshawar. This road is still in use. In modern times, the highway starts from Bangladesh and from Howrah is proceed to West Bengal. Thereafter, it goes to Delhi and to Amritsar, from there to Lahore and Peshawar, and in the end to Kabul.